off of my underweight. I can get back to you. You might want to. Thanks for having me again. It's been, we think, what, 4 years since I've been here?
At least four.
Not 4 years?
Yeah, four or five.
Yeah, that's right. So I'm giving the same talk you gave last time as I realized short-term memory lapse. It works to my advantage. I have three jokes, but I can tell them every couple of years.
Nobody remembers.
Okay, so my talk today is a couple of parts to it. One of them is a paper I've recently published in GSA Bulletin, and then I'm going to end with some work I'm trying to get done now. And I'm working with geophysicists on both these papers. The main one for this first talk is Li Jun Liu, who is a geodynamic modeler at Illinois, and we're trying to work with him on understanding the topography development of the western U.S. sort of prior to and during the Laramide orogeny. So just to make sure we're all on the same page, I just want to outline the geologic history. There's probably no way of actually. I stand here, am I in people's way? Well, there's sort of odd button time, so let me try.
Peter, why don't you sit here?
I'm not sure it'll make much difference. I'm mostly worried about blocking people. So I want to briefly just outline the Mesozoic history of Western North America, just so that we're all on the same page when I allude to it. So here's a cloudless view of the Rockies, the Western U.S. here. Of course, as you know, we're roughly in that location there. And by the Rockies, I'm going to refer to this region that includes the Colorado Plateau in the southwest. And so, the key parts that are important to keep in mind is that prior to beginning of Mesozoic time, there was basically no continental volcanic arc taking place beneath Western North America. Latest Permian, perhaps, but by Triassic time, there's evidence of subduction beginning in the southwest part of the U.S. and volcanic rocks right behind it, which is one of the reasons why Las Vegas is so hot, in fact. So this is Triassic time shown over there. By Jurassic time, volcanism had moved up and down throughout the Cordillera, so clearly there's subduction beneath the continent taking place at this time. And these within the thrust belt, within the volcanic arc, are localized areas of shortening of thrust belts. By Cretaceous time, thrusting stepped to the east to give us the severe belt over here. And by late Cretaceous into the Eocene, volcanism then had migrated to be a very broad, diffuse area of eruptions. So this is often referred to as the magmatic gap or magmatic knoll by some people. There's quite a bit of volcanism, but it's really scattered over a very large area. And so then we have the Laramide orogeny. So I'm basically calling everything east of the severe belt. The Laramide, the uplifts are shown here in blue. This is more or less the region. And you'll notice that we're talking about deformation here that's more than 1,000 kilometers inboard of the continental margin at the time. So in fact, I think Black Hills, at least even when you reconstruct it for the extension that's taken place since then, it's about 1,700 kilometers inboard of the continental margin. So there's been an argument in the literature about what caused the shortening this far inboard during late Cretaceous time. And these are the two schools of thought. There's a school of thought that Eric Grisla, for example, likes to believe, which is the idea of an end load. The idea of an end load here is that by enhanced compression along the margin, you're able to transmit stress through the entire plate, North American plate, so that means all these uplifts would take place basically at the same time. The stress would have been induced sort of instantaneously. The second idea is that for reasons of convergence rates and buoyancy, the subducting slab became flattened and began to interact with the base of North America. And so as a result, you have stress transmitted directly below the plate that would immediately be associated somehow with shortening above the plate here. So this would be time transgressive, was the idea behind it. This is the most popular idea about why the Laramide took place. And that's, I would say, less popular, though it fits better with parts of South America. My sole contribution to the NOVA story on the Rockies was this diagram, which sort of shows that the idea the plate begins to subduct at flatter and flatter angles here, more interaction, and then as a result, you have shortening in the upper plate that's associated with a migration of this interaction to give you the Laramide orogeny. So my old advisor was Bill Dickinson, and years ago in the 80s, he published a paper where he tried to look at when did the Laramide orogeny begin and when did it end. So this is a plot that goes from south New Mexico to north to Montana with ages from 75 to 30 million years ago. In the case of the end of the Laramide, he showed, if he compiled the data that he could find, that the Laramide ended in Montana relatively early, around 65 million years ago. And as you go to the south, it got younger and younger, and it ended much younger as you go into the southwestern US. But in terms of when the Laramide began, when he compiled all the data, he said it's virtually instantaneous, plus or minus 5 million years, 70 million years, plus or minus 5. All these symbols represent their identifiers for the beginning of the Laramide orogeny. So if that's true, it would be consistent with the idea of the end loop. That there's just sheer, there's some sort of stress was transmitted throughout the continent. Everybody sort of popped up at the same time as a result. Well, since that paper in the 80s, there's been more studies on the Laramide and timing of the Laramide, but it hadn't been compiled. So what I want to do is show you a compilation of these data. So this is a map of the Laramide orogenies. In gray are the uplifts. Yellow are the basins. Here's the severe belt in red off to the west. And just going through the literature and some of our own work, these are locations where people at least tentatively identified the beginning of deformation in the Laramide. When did it begin? So I'm going to take that diagram and I'm going to plot everything along a trajectory like this, which is parallel to the average direction of plate motions, North America and the Pacific Basin plates, the Farallon primarily here, underneath it, just to sort of see how it looks. And this is what I find. So again, we're going here from southwest to northeast, from a period of about 80 to 55 million years ago. These data come from various types of things in the literature, including when did you have paleocurrent directions shifting, suggesting local uplifts, local conglomerate shedding, fault overlaps, angular unconformities, similar. Flexural asymmetry, with the idea there is that if you take a mountain belt and you place it on an elastic plate, such as Earth, you'll get a basin that's going to be strongly asymmetric beneath that load. And thermochronology shown in blue. I show it in blue because of all this data, I would expect the thermochronology to be younger than the actual event. Is it not necessarily? So if you look at this, you'll see there's a nice trend overall. It runs from southwest to northeast. That just doing a best fit through the midpoints of all these data sets, about 6 centimeters per 1,000 years. And I compare that with the rate of the Farallon convergence with North America, averaged over this time, it's about 8 centimeters per 1,000 years. To me, it looks pretty reasonable, given all the uncertainties in the system. Some oddballs sticking up here, down there. But I would say overall, to me, it looks like it's time transgressive. That it began to the southwest and it migrated towards the Black Hills at a rate that you might expect if there's interaction directly with a Farallon plate underneath it. Okay, now relating that to uplift of the surface. So I assume many of you are familiar with the idea of isostasy. That is, if you take a solid material here, sitting on a liquid down underneath here, and you hang something heavy, put a heavy anchor on it, that will isostatically will pull down the density distribution will end up pulling down the upper plate, giving you a basin, a low spot here. Everything above this, what's called the depth of compensation, below which there's no density contrast. So basically, if you put an anchor, attach it to this plate here, it'll pull everything down. The idea of dynamic topography is slightly different. In dynamic topography, what happens is, am I blocking everybody? I'm sorry, I don't know how to get out of the way.
Keep moving.
How about now?
Keep moving.
Okay, well, if I stand here.
Stay in motion.
Yeah. Brownian motion, but my name's Heller, not Brown. Anyway, so what happens though if this take this dense mass and you decouple it from the plate and let it sink? What happens in that case, as it drops down, the fluid behind it moves in behind it and you get a hydrostatic stress generated along the base of the upper plate, which also pulls down. They refer to that as dynamic topography. That is, the substance you would get above that is formed because of the motion of the material, not because of the isostatic density contrast, simply because the thermosphere mantle is flowing in behind it. So this idea it's been around a long time. I think Gernis at Caltech really has pushed it as a major influence on why large-scale basins form in the world. And people think they can find evidence for this feature. This comes from a study by Boshi in the Mediterranean. And what they did is they did this. They said, let's take the surface topography and let's subtract out all the isostatic components, the crustal thicknesses, the density of the lithosphere thickness, and look at the remnants. And we'll say that must be other processes than isostasy that's causing there to be topography. And if you do that, if you remove it, they came up with a figure like this. Areas that are in light and red are high, areas in dark blue are low. And they suggest then that you can have topography on the scale of a couple of kilometers or wavelengths of hundreds of kilometers causing these highs. They propose that this must be that component of mantle flow. Areas that where the mantle moves upward, it pushes the surface upward. Where the mantle moves downward, it pulls the surface downward slightly. I think those numbers are big, but okay, that's what they came up with. Well, one of the things...
Can I ask a question?
Excuse me. Yes.
Those dark blue areas, are those areas of increased volcanism, and is there a correlation between volcanic activity and those colors?
Yes, in the grossest sense, which I'll mention now. I think they're associated... There are certainly areas, we'll move into the next slide, but not directly in the blue areas or red areas.
Okay.
They're associated... certainly, there's association... In most models, there's an association with subduction zones, with mantle topography. In that sense, yes, they don't cause volcanism per se. But most people who have modeled these processes on Earth would predict that behind subduction zones and volcanic arcs, there'd be zones of dynamic substance. Basically, as this plate gets dragged down, it sucks in mantle behind it, which also has a downward dynamic motion. So you get isostatic uplift here, you get dynamic substance behind the arcs, and then that would be true for the and as well. But and the predictions from these models would be that the scale of this event would be on a scale of hundreds of kilometers, 1,000 kilometers, and an amplitude of a kilometer or so. These are not giant; they're giant basins in area, but they're not giant basins in depth. But they're very widespread. The trick about them is if they're dynamic, caused by motions, they migrate at plate tectonic rates. You would not expect to see one constant event. It'll move as the plate densities and motions change. So people think they see this today. So here's two examples of arcs with basins behind them. This is the Aleutians, and here's a cross section through the Aleutian arc. So here's the trench. This is topography now, or bathymetry. Then behind the trench is the volcanic arc high, and then there's a broad basin here in the Bering Sea, which has a wavelength of about 1,100 kilometers and an amplitude on a scale of a kilometer or so. Here's Tonga, chromatic arc, going through the Southwest Pacific. This cross-section here is shown again, subduction going underneath the broad arc, and then again this broad basin, hundreds of kilometers across, on a scale of a kilometer or so relief. So their argument is that it's natural when you have subduction to set this this dynamic process behind it in the mantle, which ends up sucking down the upper plate.
So this is how you're forming back arc basins?
Back arc basins are truly extensional. These are not
okay.
necessarily extensional. Back arc basins are not everywhere behind arcs. So if you look at the Mesozoic history of North America, it's true there is a basin behind the arcs as they develop. I'm not sure if this is the reason for them, but there certainly you can plot this up. Here's a late Triassic showing you where the arc was, and then this is an area where there are slopes, the Shinrock conglomerate, if you're familiar with it, in the Chinle formation, coming down slopes behind the arc and churning and going out to the moraine here. These are gravels. They have slopes. They had slopes at the time of about a meter per kilometer. So there's a significant tilt behind the arc, as seen by fluvial beings, rivers shedding gravels. Here is the Aeolian sand seas that make up the early Jurassic, Dramatic, Navajo sandstone, etc. In a low spot on the backside of the arc. This is a Middle Jurassic Sundance Sea, which again is its primary axis is off behind, directly behind the arc here. In the early Cretaceous, late Jurassic time. There's another big fluvial conglomerate unit in Wyoming. It's called the Cloverleaf Formation in most places. A thin, they're very distinctive, gravel, river-laid gravels that are requires tilting to get them to build them out the way they are. Covers a huge area, basically, right behind the arc. There's the Western Interior Seaway. And so the idea is that basically as the arc built through time and the subduction continued through time, you see this generally eastward migration of a low spot to the east of the volcanic arc as it developed. That's not proof that that's the origin of it, but it's consistent. Well, this brings me to the work that Li Jun did with Mike Gernis on predicting what dynamic topography history would be. So let me explain this briefly to you. This is just a simple numeric model. It's an inverse effective model. So the way it works here is, first thing he started with a present day view of what the seismic tomography of the mantle is. This is basically using earthquake data to look for areas of fast and slow mantle. Same thing you do in a CAT scan. X-rays going through you make images in the same way that they make images of where faster and slower materials are at depth. The interpretation is that areas that are fast are colder. They could also be drier. Or if they're red, they're slower than usual, than average, which means they're either warmer or wetter. So the interpretation that he makes is that all of the velocity features that he sees are related to warmer and colder features in the mantle. So here's a cross-section that runs across the North American plate out to the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. And here we're looking at a depth down below 1,600 kilometers. And what you're seeing here in the interpretation is you're seeing the old Farallon slab. The colder, higher velocity feature is dipping off as North America overruns this plate. So the interpretation that many people have made is that you can still see the slabs down there today if you take a really good photograph. So what he does, this is established by other people. They've been doing that a long time. Steve Grand did it, or I think originally, and Schmidt here does it in this cross section, but they have it in arrogantly covered, not just this cross section. So what Li Jun did is he took all these images of plates today, and then he took the plate motion rates. He took basically the motion of the Farallon plate with respect to North America, said, well, if this is the Farallon plate, I can play this back through time. Basically run the movie backwards, assuming the plate motions that people have established independently between North America and the Pacific Basin. Then he couples that with a conductive, a thermal conduction model. So how would that change the plate density and basically plate density? But basically how much difference in contrast would there be in these colors as it goes back in time? It got colder over time. He has to put back the heat as he moves it that way. And then he integrates this backwards. He keeps going backwards steps. Now there's more and more uncertainties as you go back, but the idea is you can play it in the inverse direction. The other part that he has to do is, this modeling requires you to have some rheology of what the mantle looks like. He's only looking at depths below 200 kilometers, so the upper, you don't even see the upper plate. You're looking only down beneath the lithosphere of North America. So we're only looking at impacts of this lower plate moving through time. So there's uncertainties in the rheologies. And so the way that that group handled it is they used some geologic data to constrain what the rheology is down there of the mantle, up on the lower mantle. And they do that with a variety of methods. They use some data from substance histories of wells, thermal data here, and they use the existence of the Western Interior Basin, Seaway, in the isopach thickness overall of the unit, and where the shorelines were, to try to constrain what's a reasonable rheology that I can put into the model. So it's not perfect. So let me make this caveat right now. I'm interested in understanding how the evolution of subsidence back here compares to the dynamic subsidence history. And it's a little bit circular, because they use that basin to constrain the rheology. So it's not going to be a shock that I should match it somehow. So don't. My work is great, don't get me wrong, but it's not as good as it's going to seem. You just have to realize that there's some circularity because I'm, by definition, using the fact that there's a basin out here which is what I'm going to be looking at in detail. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to look in more detail at other aspects of the stratigraphy and timing and locations and the migrations, but the magnitudes are going to match by definition. So don't, so caveat emptor. Okay, so here is his model today. A map view of the whole North American plate here. We are looking at, take this model and you integrate it through the entire outer part of the Earth, and you calculate areas that should be high, assuming everything is thermal, it should be cold. So this would be areas that, deep. So the blue areas are going to be areas that are low, relatively. Red areas are areas that are high, relatively. The scale is going to be a kilometer either way. And it's all relative to an assumed datum, which is shown here in white, basically. That's sort of a shoreline. That datum does not include lots of stuff. It doesn't include the fact that the crust, anything in the upper part of the upper plate is not in it. The lithosphere, densities, thicknesses, crust, sea level changes. So it's not a real sea level. It's just a horizontal datum. Because we're just looking at what's the effect of the dynamic impact of the mantle moving around at depth. So we'll play it back in time. There it is today. Notice that the Mississippi River is going to be going down beneath this low, which makes sense. It's a low spot.
Should we be worried that the Atlantic Ocean shows to be high?
Again, yeah, no, you shouldn't be worried. Again, don't forget, we're talking there, we're not looking at anything, we're not looking at the fact that it's thin crust,
okay,
for example, right? So that's not in there. This is just looking at the mantle effects.
Okay.
So we're playing it back through time. You can see a wave playing it backwards to 100 million years ago. It's as far back as you have the plate history of any record. It's going to be less and less exact as you go back. I can't say exact. Less precise. It's probably not accurate anyway. But it's not. The precision gets worse. So it's a couple of things to see here. Basically, of course, the wave is because that's the plate motion. That's what it's caused by. That's why these features move. They always move because they're due to plate interactions. You'll notice that as this blue area moves back, a particularly dark area forms. A sort of a bullseye zone that heads out here. It gets out here around 90 million years ago. Just playing it backwards. An area of particular deep, at least modeled history of substance. And that's a very important feature. In fact, that feature that gets there about 90 million years ago is this feature here. So it's about 90 million years ago. These are areas of, this is an effective temperature down at a depth of 200 kilometers. Yeah. So the key point is that the prediction is that this feature is something that would have been at the shoreline. Now this is pounds fastly restored, sort of the western, southwestern US at around 90 million years ago. And this feature has been interpreted by other people in different ways in the past. That feature is referred to as the conjugate Shatsky rise. This comes from plate tectonic, people studying plate motions in the Pacific. In the Western Pacific, there are these large oceanic plateaus, including the Shatsky Rise. Shatsky Rise is about 600 kilometers by 300 kilometers across, and it sits above the seafloor around it between 2.5-3 kilometers higher. People have dated it, and they've gone back and seen where would it have formed based on plate motions at the time when it formed, what was the setting. And these suggest that the Shatsky Rise formed along the spreading center between the Faroe and Pacific plate. And the interpretation of the volcanism and the fact that it's sitting on the ridge has been interpreted to be that it was a hot spot sitting beneath the spreading center. Hot spots like that do exist beneath spreading centers, and what they do is they create mirror images of each other because the spreading center is pulling away. So anything that happens on this side more or less would happen on the opposite side. This one would have been called the conjugate Shatsky Rise because that's the Shatsky Rise. You can see that today. If we go up here into the northern Atlantic, here's the mid-ocean spreading center in the Atlantic, here's Iceland, here's a hot spot track. Iceland's about 17 million years old. So when the hot spot was approaching the ridge at the time, notice that land formed on both sides from eruptions. It's the same idea here, that there would be one side, Iceland, and then the conjugate Iceland. On both sides. So the idea is that there would be land produced on both sides. This idea has been around for a while. The downside of it, of course, is that there's no evidence that this thing existed. There's no docked eventually this thing would move across the Pacific on this plate and dock in North America. And you can't find physical evidence of that rock at the surface. So this is a reconstruction from plates. About 90 million years ago, they would guess this Shasky Rise, which had formed out in the Jurassic out here, would become in contact with southwestern North America. Here, at around the same time, in roughly the same area that this anomaly that we see when playing the plates backwards is in the same region. So again, it's not proof, but it's certainly it's consistent using two different data sets. It's consistent that there was a feature that formed that interacted with North America sometime around 85 or 90 million years ago.
What's the difference between the yellow S and the red S?
Yeah, you're going to ask that. depends upon what ridge it actually formed on. It's an uncertainty based on whether you put it on, I can't remember. Is it Kula Fairlawn? There's a slight difference, then that's what that's supposed to represent, uncertainty.
When you played it backwards, I thought the deep blue seemed to be at the end of its life, kind of headed to the southwest part of the continent.
Yeah,
here it seems to be more in the northwest corner of the continent.
No. This is not a deep substance now. The blue here represents differences in temperature. This is basically a 200 kilometer
slice
depth. Okay. Yeah, slice and relative effective temperatures. It's not subsidence and uplift. Okay. This is just a slice. So the idea goes like this. North America is here. In this case, I took pounds spastically, took back the extension. And this feature would come in and collide with North America somewhere in that window and beneath here. And then, as long as it's still attached to the Fairlawn plate, it would be dragged underneath North America, moving across this region. And that would be consistent with playing the thermal model backwards that he had done.
And this is essentially a higher.
Okay. So it's higher topographically.
Okay.
So the question is, what's the effect in dynamics of having higher crust?
Right.
And it turns out that it creates more shear stress because it's a tighter channel, which you're moving the same material through. So you increase the velocity and the tight. And the small hose versus the wide hose, the velocity goes up, so you actually get more substance. See, this works. Yeah. So here's a little, using his cartoons for the western U.S., here's the conjugate Shasky Rise 100 million years ago. So again, this is this topography, calculated topography. And the idea goes, this thing would get here somewhere around 90 million years ago. There's the center of the rise. As it migrates to the northeast, CO2 is a substance. Now I'm just showing you the centers. Notice the maximum substance would occur in the front edge as it moves through. That's that blob we saw before. And it moves out of the picture frame by 60 million years ago. So that's what I'm looking for. Is that feature, that may be the feature that generates things like the Western Interior Seaway. What's the relationship between that and the beginning of the Laramide Orogeny? How does that relate to major unconformities? Can I pull apart whether I can see this evidence of subsidence followed by uplift behind it? In redder colors means that it's higher. So we're looking for all those sort of details. So if I make a cross-section, more or less, I guess not quite parallel to the direction of average motion here, I'm going to make a cross-section through this area from the southwest to northeast based on his model results. And so he would suggest that basically here's the plate underneath, starting about 200 kilometers down here, moving beneath it. This is his reconstructed thickness using, again, the density anomalies that we see in the seismic tomography. This is his predicted topography from the effect of it. So there'd be a dimple. Again, that's 1 kilometer, so it's hundreds of meters, sort of dimple moving through. That's at 80 million years ago. Here it is at 70, it's moved to the northeast. There's the subsidence associated with it. And here it is at 60 million years ago, it's sort of moving out of the picture. Now it's got quite a bit of subsidence as it moves past. Remember, it was getting bluer and bluer as it moved. It's getting deeper and deeper. That's basically the model now in cross-section. So, as I said, our goal was to try to determine, can I see any, besides the fact that we know it's circular, right, that he uses the subsidence of the whole Western Interior Seaway to get this. Can I look at the evolution of the Laramide orogeny related to this passage and whether it hangs together? So, as basically in all these basins, I try to pull out the history of subsidence and erosion, which would presumably be uplift, potentially, in all these basins through the region, and try to compile that all together for comparison. So this just shows you the stratigraphy I used from 100 to 50 million years ago, from southwest to northeast. Areas in green are the offshore marine, and in this yellow would be the nearshore deposits, coastal plain in this whatever that is, light orange, darker orange for fluvial, and then black are these unusual conglomerates, which I may have talked about X years ago when I was here. These conglomerates are bizarre. They're not your typical gravels that you find associated with tectonism. Do the following. As mountains build, the gravels reach farther and farther and farther out into a basin. And so what you get is a coarsening upward sequence of gravels. It's relatively thick because the basin is also subsiding rapidly from the mountains building. These don't do that. They come on, they're sheet-like, they don't thicken. They're very, very thin, tongues of gravel that are very extensive, hundreds of kilometers. They come on like that, they turn off like that. They're just long. They're shown here in black. Here's an example of one of these gravels in the Book Cliffs of Utah. This section down here is a fluvial coastal plain deposit. There's a weathering horizon formed because the area was coming up. There's these gravels, a little tongue of this gravel coming out, and then it stops. And you can trace this for hundreds of kilometers through the basin. Then it goes fluvial, the Wasatch Formation above it.
They're distributary fans.
Excuse me?
Are they distributary fans?
No, these seem they're river deposits. They might be braided. I don't know how one ever tells if a river is really braided or not in the ancient, but people call them braided rivers. They're clearly bars, river bars, in any case. So again, these are these gravels that we see. The paleocurrents and the stuff right below the gravels are going basically eastish. But when the gravels come in, most of them have shifted directions. Most of them go to the north. The area in the San Juan Basin actually sheds off to the southeast, moves slightly. In the Front Range, they don't change direction. So the point is there's a change in paleocurrents from the stuff below, there's an unconformity, and then these gravels come in a new direction. So I wanted to see how those features fit in as well. So we did is we took sections from wells mostly in all these basins, shown by the black dots, and looked at the history of subsidence and uplift in them. I'm going to show you two just to lay out how we plotted it. One from the farthest southwest down here in the Caparitz Plateau and Northern Bighorn Powder River Basin. I'll show you another one. So these are plots of subsidence history. So this is the magnitude in kilometers of subsidence. And I plotted here a horizon that's about 100 million years old. And this is showing you the trajectory of that downward motion of that to about 50, the black line. I've removed the effects of sediment loading, isostasy from the fact that you put sediments in basins. Let's see, what else do I need to explain? Oh, right. Gaps represent unconformities where I don't have data. The thickness of the lines represent an uncertainty in where you are with respect to sea level. So if you're below sea level, it's an uncertainty in water depth, or above sea level, it's an uncertainty in paleo altitude. So we try to put an estimate of what's kind of the range of uncertainties. So you can see that this basin here, subsidence was taken by 100 million years ago. This basin started subsiding. Again, there's a lot of uncertainties in people picking horizons, and it's wobbly data. In any case, there's a big pulse of subsidence here, somewhere in the 70 million years ago, and then it flattens out again. So overall, it's constant here, more or less, speeds up and then flattens. And that's in the southwestern U.S. In the Powder River Basin, again, it's more or less continuous. There might be a slight acceleration around 88 million years ago or so. Begins to slow down, then it takes off. So next thing I can do is I can plot independent data, when did Laramide motions begin nearby? These are based those compilation I showed you before. I just took those things and plotted one here. So in the southwestern US, Kaibab uplift takes place here. It's around the time the gravels take off. and the Big Horn Mountains, and then the Black Hills take place at these times. It's around the time the basin subsides. So we assume that these rapid pulses of subsidence is when nearby mountains were coming up, causing the plate of North America to bend because of the weight of the mountains. So I show that now, just generalizing by yellow, and you can see that in both these cases, the subsidence is more or less coincident when nearby mountain building, the Laramide, takes place. So I can do that for all these basins. I'm going to lay them out in and basically in this geography, I'm going to show southwest to northeast for all these basins here. Right, so there they are for all of those. So this goes from the southwest. I laid these out as this is the most southwest. That's the most northeast. These tend to be more northerly. These tend to be easterly basins. And in most places, you can see that the beginning of the Laramide orogeny is coincident with an acceleration of subsidence. Not everywhere, certainly not. This one seems like an oddball here. Don't see a lot of subsidence, maybe a little pulse in here, but that's a couple million years. I'm not sure if that's a dating problem. That's just what I have in the literature. Let's see, what else is important here? Some places, notice it looks like the mountain building takes place and the area stops. As soon as that Laramide begins, this is a basin, I don't see any more subsidence taking place. What else can we see here? I'm going to look at my notes for a second.
So is there more subsidence in the Piance Basin than the Green River Basin?
Well, let's look.
Am I reading that right?
The Green River Basin here has a lot of subsidence beginning about 90, you mean magnitude?
Yes.
There's about, what, a kilometer of subsidence from here to here? And from here to here, there's about a kilometer and a half.
But the Piance is actually a younger structure than the Green River?
The Green River, I use the Uinta Uplift in both. It's the same structure because of both sides of the Uintas.
I'm just trying to understand the dynamics of the graph itself. It looks like the Green River happened before the Piance happened.
The
just
Green
based
River,
on the age.
You mean the Uplift or the subsidence?
Subsidence.
Substance begins here very strongly at about 89, that 90 million years ago, and the Piance, that's about 90 million years ago.
Okay, I get it. I see.
They're both around the same time. There's, again, it's how many biozones. My ability to do this is only as good as the paleontology that constrains it. The one weird one I want to point out is the Hanna Basin here in south central Wyoming. The Hanna Basin is in one deep basin. This is subsidence of 4 kilometers, and then sediment filled it in, which exaggerated to about 8 to 10 kilometers of thickness. There's no well that goes through the whole section in the Hanna, so these are all different authors' field major sections. They vary. But the point is, so I showed all the ones I could find. You can see that this basin subsided like rapidly, but no faster than most of these other basins, about a kilometer and a half to 2 kilometers. But once the Laramide began, this basin really took off, and the other ones don't take off as much.
Could you tell us again where the Hanna Basin is?
Oh, right. I should
back geographers, non-geographers.
Bingo.
This little guy here.
Yeah.
Oh, that little guy.
He's a little, okay. But deep. A little bit deep. I have a story I'm trying to work on that one too, why it's doing that. But the point is, it's big substance. When the Laramide took place there, this basin, I think, was a broken basin. It tilted like a seesaw. It just went. So a short wavelength, but very deep. It's hard to get data to prove it because it's so deep. All right. The point is, I think at first order, there's some places that you wonder about, like this guy. I would have thought the Uintas would have more of a direct effect there. It is what it is. So then the question is, what does Liu's model predict? So these are the southwestern section and the Powder River Basin section. Those are his estimates of what the history of substance would be. So I just compared it. And again, I would get too excited by the fact that they match grossly, because overall it's designed to match grossly. But the rates, which aren't matched, the rates are not bad. As well as, but notice there's a turnaround. The turnaround in the model suggests that around 85 million years ago, this basin would start coming up as that plateau moved past. Whereas this basin doesn't turn around until about 70 or 65 million years ago. So notice there was a big departure. The first parts match. In part, they kind of match. Anyway, they have to. But in part, they fall apart at some point. But you're also at the points in which the Laramide takes place. So I interpret this to mean that these basins, this whole area of the western U.S. was sinking. And you would expect these areas to come back up. Except the local Laramide uplifts came up, and they basically trapped the sedimentary. They basically forced it down above and beyond what he would predict. So I think that this difference is what's caused by the Laramide loading, by the Laramide uplifts. They trapped the sediment. Which means, of course, that if you don't have Laramides nearby, your expectation is that there would be an unconformity. The section would have, basin would have formed, then it would come back up and get eroded away. And I'll note that in the western Great Plains, the stratigraphy is missing, that the stratigraphy age is missing. So I wouldn't be surprised if that there was a more section out there, but then it was brought back up by these dynamic processes. But, you know, an absence of evidence is not evidence of absence, as Napoleon said. I don't know. I'm sorry.
So the dash red line is your model.
That's the model.
And the black.
Black is what we use from the substance history. And the yellow is
sediment fill, right?
What's that?
It's essentially sediment fill.
Right, though I remove the effect of the sediment.
So it's kind of harder data than the model.
Oh, okay. They're not even the same planet.
Depends on what you're going through, how hard.
If you're thinking data, you're in the wrong room. it's a snapshot today that they feel pretty confident about. Way back, 100 million years, so, you know, copy of them for it. And so the same idea is here, is that they're in these areas. It seems to me that once the Laramide starts, this basin continues to subside, although the background substance would be bringing it up. That's all. So, doing that, we can try to look at this history now in a map view a little bit. So I'm going to play this movie again, slower, of the western U.S. at different times. So this is 100 million years ago. These colors here represent areas that are low by a kilometer, areas that are high relative to some arbitrary sea level, and the coming of the conjugate Shatsky Rise. I've added in here the eastern edge of the volcanic arc based on, there's a online computer program that compiles all the ages for volcanism in the western U.S. That's where this comes from. So that's the eastern edge of volcanism. I also can just show you where the severe belt would be, just over here, at around this time, 100 million years ago. And here we are at 98. So the conjugate Shatsky Rise is sort of getting into the neighborhood at this time. Here's the arc front. And over here I plot something different. I plot here the rates of subsidence. That is, I'm plotting here basically centimeters per thousand years. Which way is it moving? Not where it is in space, but which direction is it going? So these are 4 million year windows. It's comparing two models at 4 million years and saying, okay, so at 98 million years ago, this looks at what's the difference from 100 million years ago to 96 million years ago. It's just a rate. This is an elevation of this data. So otherwise, the figures are the same. So this area, notice, is high, but it's going downward. This area is relatively high, relatively low, the bluish area, but it's coming upward. Okay, so the first thing I did is I plotted these areas of Cretaceous unconformity development. Meriwether and Cobbin, USGS folks worked on this in the Cretaceous using biostratigraphy. They mapped out areas where there's gaps in the rock record. So I took the areas of the greatest gaps and I outlined them. And notice that this area where rocks are of this age are missing are taking place where the model would be coming off a high going into a low. Which sort of makes sense, because you would think as this area sinks, we should start seeing some evidence of overlap. The unconformity sediment might be coming in on top of it. So there's the area at 94. Here it is at 92. And here it is at 88. So it's moving eastward. It's moving eastward where it's more or less coincident with the plate motions. Whether you believe this color band, I don't care. But the point is, a migration of unconformities moves eastward at the same rate that you would expect the topography should be moving eastward.
And is it significant that it's also getting smaller?
It's also being what?
It appears to be getting smaller.
Well, partly that's again, I mapped, it's a broader area, I mapped where the greatest amount of rocks are missing. So there's a little artistic, the size of it is a little bit artistic because I did not sure. I just said, where is the biggest gap, hiatus taking place? So now I plot on here that from all those subsidence curves, when does the rapid subsidence begin? That first evidence of rapid subsidence. And you'll notice here, so 88 million years ago, these areas are all beginning to sink fairly rapidly within my biostratigraphic resolution. And then they might reach the east as well, as the basin starts to be lower and lower. Now I plot in black the evidence I have for the beginning of the Laramide deformation. When did the mountain start building? The circle here is the middle of the conjugate Chatsky rise. So basically, you can see that these areas of Laramide beginning is taking place after this low spot is passing by, sort of on the back side of it. Sort of between where the most rapid falling and the most rapid uplift is taking place. Again, notice that the Laramide beginning is more or less coincident with the midpoint of this conjugate Chatsky rise, which is on the back side of the subsidence. Same is true here. Notice what happened in that last diagram. I skipped over it. The arc takes a giant jump. Because the Colorado Mineral Belt takes off at this time. That jump is too fast to be plate tectonics. There's no way that that's a plate tectonic event. There's a lot of interpretations of what that volcanism is. But once the volcanic front moves to here, it sort of stays here. That's clearly not plate tectonics. So again, the Laramide deformation is following the midpoint of the conjugate Chatsky rise. The arc is more or less coincident with that too. These are when my gravels start coming off, those sheet-like gravels. Notice they're tend to be coming off areas that are coming up. And they're being shed off this feature. Again, there's the gravels again. They tend to be shedding off to the north as this area comes back up behind the high. There's the beginning of the Laramide in the Bighorn Mountains, around the Bighorn Basin. And then the Black Hills take place sort of at the same time. So to me, it seems like the stratigraphy in gross sense seems to record his calculated. I can't do magnitude either, but it certainly fits with his overall story. So the results of that are shown here. That part of the talk is here, that the time and location of the onset of rapid subsidence, these gray dots, is followed by uplift. It's consistent with the passage of the conjugate Chatsky rise, which is the white dot moving through. That the Laramide was time transgressive. It began older down here, shown by the black dots coming up here, and migrates through as the subsidence moves through. So it's right where it goes from red to sort of blue that stuff moves through. His model matches not just, we know it's going to match in the grossest sense, but it seems to match in more detail as well, at least from the stratigraphy that I could find. Right. So that's that first story. I just tried to see if that relates it. So I would interpret that even though this is not the Laramide Basin formation, there's a gross uplift in subsidence of Western North America. It's still happening today. It happens around the world today. It's small scale, that it's only a kilometer or so, and over large wavelengths, it's 1,000 kilometers wide. That scale seems to fit, I think, overall with the stratigraphy.
Now, if you were to, instead of having a map view, if you were to have a cross-section through time, what do you visualize as going on underneath the crust here? So is this...
You mean on the mantle?
A continental, have we subducted a island arc underneath here? Or, you know, what do you think is going on in depth here? These ups and downs coming through.
Well, if this conjugate Chatsky rise existed, I think the fronting, so here's the midpoint, here's the Chatsky rise, and here's the midpoint. Right. This polar is being pulled down by the plate subducting.
Okay.
So it tends to pull, most of the substance is going to occur at this part of the hinge.
Right.
It's going to pull it like this. So I think the subsidence pattern fits the fact that basically as this plate, this is the subducted slab here, as this plate gets pulled down, You see substance in the leading edge.
Right.
And you see relative uplift in the backside with respect to the overall system, mm-hmm. because it's behaving more like a cantilever as it moves through. But there's a channel between this deposit. It's not rubbing the base of the upper plate. To get the substance, you need there to be actually mantle flow.
Okay.
And the mantle flow is concentrated in the frontal part where it's being pulled down. Mm-hmm. So we're seeing most of the suction occurring where that little wedge of asthenes. I mean, this is just my guess.
Yeah. Right?
So I think we're just seeing the waves that we see move through. This is not that.
So the uplift of the Laramide, you think, is pretty much related to the conjugate ridge coming.
I think there's a coincidence between when the Laramide starts, when the midpoint of the conjugate Shatsky rise passes, and where the arc is, which represents, presumably the presence of the arc is the position where the lower plate's 150, 175 kilometers down. So they're all coupled together, and they're all controlled by what the buoyancy of that plate is, and to a lesser extent, the rigidity of that plate.
So can we credit the conjugate Shatsky rise as why you have subduction-related uplift 1,700 kilometers inland from the subduction itself?
Right. I think this more buoyant, thicker body played an important role for why the Laramide is where it is. There's deformation not just in the Rockies at this time due to the passage of the plates underneath. They're not exactly at the same time. But I think this particularly this basement-involved uplift story seems grossly coincident where you don't know what this thing really looked like.
But it fits
where the motion goes.
Is there evidence of any place else on the planet where you have uplift that far from a subduction zone?
Yes. Well, there's the basin that we see here, the equivalent of the Western Interior Basin, is equivalent to what you see in the South American Andes. We have the altiplano is a high, and the thrust is moving inboard, and the thrust step way in, and it turns out in the Andes, which is happening today, the areas where there's in front of the arc, there's the subandean belt, thrust belt. And that belt, as you go north and south through the Andes, that belt steps way out, then comes back and steps way out. And that is coincident with, from my seismology, of where the plates are flatter and steeper.
But what constitutes way out? Do you have 1,700 kilometers?
Actually, the argument goes that it's similar to what the Andes do. Don't forget it. Once you take the extension back out, that took place subsequently, it goes on the scale of 1,000 kilometers inboard on parts of the subandean belt in the Pampeanus ranges that even look like Laramide. They show some reverse directions in the basement cores in places. So it's not a crazy feature because there is something like it. And where there's a topographic high being subducted beneath South America, like the conjugate Shatsky, it's called the... It's not the Nazca. I can't remember. There's a ridge there. It's high, and it's going underneath. And inboard of that, you can see everything is stepping east. And I guess I can't remember the name
Cusco?
Of the ridge.
Was it Cusco?
I don't remember.
If you said it, I would recognize it.
Total different question. What is your speculations on the Colorado mineral belt?
Not mine. The published speculations of the Colorado Mineral Belt represents a period of time, so the arc's going to take a big leap here, right?
Right.
The interpretations, and they're heavily interpreted, is that it represents a weakness in the lower plate, but actually like a transform fault, where the plate was actually breaking, mm-hmm. and so stuff was leaking up, because it's a very linear feature as well, and it's parallel to the motion. So the argument goes that the interpretation is that plate is actually kind of breaking up. So as it's going down, there's like an old transform or something here, and the thing is like doing this a little bit, and stuff is leaking out. At least that's the most common suggestion in recent times. I'm not sure it's right. So people try to work with, not kimberlites, but xenoliths, and try to get depths and compositions. It's not my bag, so I don't know. But that is the thinking is that it's clearly not plate tectonics, but it could be related to fractures in the lower plate.
So,
yes, sir.
So the severe would have happened without the conjugate ridge.
Oh, I think the severe, yeah. I mean, there's lots of places in the world that have thrust belts behind the subduction zones that are not far inland.
Are they typically as thin-skinned as the severe?
Say that again?
Are they typically as thin-skinned?
No, these are thin-skinned. Behind the elutions, there's an ice. I mean, they're supercrustal. When you say thin-skinned, well, we see the severe. We see the supercrustal upper core rocks. But if you go back into Nevada, you can see basement on basement. I mean, those thrusts are not just in the uppermost few kilometers. They are. Don't forget, the severe is localized by the fact that when North America rifted back in Precambrian time, late Precambrian time, the basement goes from shallow, just like off of New Jersey. I hate to compare anything to New Jersey. I say that my wife was raised in New Jersey, but then I think about it and I say she was lowered in New Jersey. But the position of the severe is coincident with where the overlying Paleozoic section, the Myogeocline, goes from thin to thick. I mean, it's localized by the geology. So it's where the stratigraphy dives down. That's also where the thrusts soul into them. So old thrust belts seem to be, in this case, are following old rift margins. Another story. Let me go to this last little piece, just a couple slides here, because we're just starting to work on this. This is something I was trying to do with Ken Duger and another. So this is an image of down 195 kilometers of areas that are earthquake velocities are either faster or slower. There are people in this room who know a lot more about this than I do. So the interpretation is, again, that these areas that are fast are either colder or drier, and areas that are in red are either warmer or wetter. And notice that, so generally it's colder, denser, under a year. This is the lower plate, 200 kilometers. We're looking into what's underneath North America. And then it's warmer off to the west. And there's 195 kilometers, yeah. But there are these features that they call anomalies, right? They include the Isabella anomaly in Southern California, Escalante here. These are little blobs of colder, denser, presumably, if they're denser. At least they're faster. And then there's the Vernal anomaly here, and then there's Powder River anomaly up here. And so a few years ago, a guy named Brandon Schmatt came to me, and this is one of his figures. And he said, what we don't know about these blobs is, are they really dense, or are they just chemically different? And the argument always goes, they're chemically different because we don't see any surface manifestation of them today. And he said, is there any way of calculating in the past what the surface was doing? Was it going up or down? And if so, when? Because that would tell us when they got emplaced. And how much? Because that would tell us how much denser that mantle is. And he wanted me to work on this guy, and I said, oh, that one sucks. There's no horizontal, paleo-horizontal conditions, but this one, that's the Green River Basin. And the Green River Basin has got a special unit in it at the oil shale. It's called Mahogany Bed down here. It's called the Laney Formation up there. And they're well-dated. They are paleo-horizontals. I can look at where that is and compare it to this anomaly and see whether it fits, how well it fits, etc. So here's a cross-section then through this vernal anomaly. Here's the vernal anomaly here. You can see there's a plate going underneath here under North America. These are depths in kilometers. And there's that feature.
Where's that data set come from, Paul? Is that part of the Earthscope?
Yes.
That's Earthscope data.
Yeah. So this feature, presumably, if it's a dense feature, should be sinking, which should exert subsidence. The surface, so that's what I was going to look for. This is actually that image of that body, sort of in quasi 3D here. So it's not just a single. I wanted it to be a cylinder because that's easy to model. But this is an idea from the Earthscope data. This is sort of the image of that body that's in place there. Some people say, okay, this body represents a piece of the conjugate chassis that ripped off. That's what Eugene Humphreys thinks, for example. If you go back to that figure. Oh, let me go back to this figure. Sorry. Oh, one more. Eugene Humphreys likes to say, look at that orientation. That's parallel and plate direction. You know? Of these pieces of the conjugate chassis that as it went underneath got ripped off during Cretaceous time, and they've been there forever.
So little bumps off the top got scraped off.
Yeah, exactly.
Basically.
Like black pits popping out of there. I mentioned that once in my introductory geology class, and A lot of kids who apparently had zits were really offended by that. I don't use that analogy again.
We're going to make you retake PC.
I can understand to be self-conscious. I was self-conscious. Anyway, right, there was that. So the idea that we had is, so here's the map of the topography today of this part of North America. There's Vernal, southwestern Wyoming. And here on that same map is that image of that seismic anomaly down at 195 kilometers, I think it is. So we wanted to say, okay, we know where this thing is. Can I map the subsidence of the mahogany of this oil shale? Right, so that gives you an idea. So it's not really centered beneath the Uintas, which if it were the Uinta load, you'd expect it to be symmetric around that. Mostly it's centered to the south of the Uintas. So this map shows you the distribution of the Green River Basin, basically this part of the Piceance and Uinta Basin, where we have data from wells, I guess they're called, right? And that unit I'm mentioning here, shown here, we can just look at the upper one. This is a lithostratigraphic section from the Uinta Basin, the Piceance, the San Wash, the Bridger Basin. So south, going kind of east, and then going to the north. And this in green is that oil shale, mahogany bed, and it's well dated. These are argon-argon dates, so it's we know the time of that bed. We know what it is. It's a distinct bed. It's only about 30 meters thick or so, and it's you can trace it. And you can see it in the well logs and everything. So the idea is, let's just pull that data. So these are the wells that have it in. There's like 3,000 wells that identify this thing in it. And then from that data, this is the structure contour. This is where that, in space, is where that feature is, the top of that feature is. So this area is about at sea level, at zero. This is sitting at 2 kilometers above sea level, 2.5 kilometers above sea level. So it's deeper here and comes up here. To the north, it's way flatter. There's way less influence on it, et cetera. Douglas Creek Arch, which is a structural here, could have had some influence on, you know, we're seeing a bend around the arch. So the idea was fairly simple. First of all, I noticed that the Uinta Mountains began to move in the late Cretaceous time. And based on people who worked in the Green River Basin and in the stratigraphy, and even in the subsidence history, it seems to end, you know, basically by the beginning of Cenozoic time. And the Uintas are sort of the latest Maastrichtian age structure. And these rocks I'm looking at are 49 million years, they're Eocene, they're the Eocene age. So what? So we try to superimpose. Basically, we looked at a comparison between we said, okay, let's take this feature. We laid out a grid, and in the grid, we pick the elevation of the average elevation of the bed, and we compared it with. We took this structure, and we started assigning different densities to it, reasonable densities, to see what's the best match we can find. What densities would we have to put in here to give me the best? Basically, where the well data and the model tend to coincide. How well can I get it to coincide? That is shown here. So what this is this is how much density faster that blob would be than the surrounding material. And so as I start increasing the density of this feature, this is the difference squared between the observed elevation and the model prediction, isostatic, what the elevation would be. And as I increase the density of that structure, I get a better and better and better fit, but I can only ascribe about 35% of the subsidence to this feature, given the shape that I was told it has. And as you make it denser, it fits worse and worse. So if I put in the Uintas, I say, well, maybe there's some motion in the Uintas to help it along. If I add the Uintas at all, it's much worse. The Uintas are not involved in that structure. There's no way that they're causing that subsidence that we're seeing. They're just not involved at all. So this is sort of where I am. I'm happy because I like this number. This is equivalent to about a 1% increase in the mantle density. It's not a giant number to make it fit. It's just that I wish that number was, you know, like a 6 instead of a 3. Right now, that's where I am. I haven't gotten any further. I haven't included anything else in this model yet. For example, we know in this region there's been isostasy due to erosion. So this is a model published by Carlstrom that suggests because of the erosion of the Green River and the Colorado River, this area would isostatically bounce up. So these, I haven't added these in yet. This is what I have to do, still ahead of me, et cetera, et cetera. To see how much of what we see in that topography represents a mantle blob. But the nice thing about it is, one, that means that that blob got there after 49 million years ago, and that caused the beds to be deflected, which is way after the Laramide. It's way, I mean, it's way after, not the end of the Laramide, but the beginning when the Shasky Rise was going underneath. We have an idea of what the density contrast is. It gives us some insight idea of what those blobs are made of, which we don't have any other way. So I like the idea that I can use basin stratigraphy to kind of pull out what the mantle structure is, if it all works out. But that's just what I'm trying to do right now. What I really want to do is I want to work on this sucker. It's way bigger. It's way denser. It's right in the middle of the Powder River Basin. I want a horizontal that I can use to pull it out. There are some coal beds, regional coal beds, which I'm going to try to play with, but this is great because you have the oil shale. I know, but this is the one that I really think you could look for. And so I'm trying to figure out what stratigraphy I could use to see if that structure is a density structure and when they got there.
Ash layers?
What's that?
Ash layers?
I suppose if you had them, yeah. Yeah, I mean, you had a clear ash layer of a region. I'm not sure. There are some ashes, I guess. I haven't thought about that.
Wouldn't they be pretty late?
Yeah. Well, they're in the Cretaceous. The Cretaceous Seaway has them. I'm suspicious that this is young.
Okay.
But, yeah, I don't know how well I can. Seeing individual ash layers in the well logs.
That's easy. They stand out like a sore thumb.
Little guys?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, this is in gamma ray? Mm-hmm. Gamma log?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, I can't say I've ever seen them in the gamma log that I've looked at them. So maybe they aren't there. I know there are, you can see ashes when you drive down Colorado in that section, older in the section. This is in fluvial too.
Yeah.
Well, no, it could be, I don't care, I'll take the marine. I haven't looked for that. I've looked for coals, but I haven't looked to see if there's a clear...
Isn't there a big ash layer in the Maori shale?
The Maori is really a siliceous, sashy thing.
Yeah, I think there's a...
The Maori might be a doable unit. Of course, then, the Maori is going to be early in the Laramide. It's going to show a lot of Laramide deflection.
Yeah, there was
that's why I like younger, so I could see is it really post Laramide. But I'll take anything. If the Maori is identifiable, there's big uranium kicks, I guess, in a Wasatch, but that's only a little pieces of the area. The Fort Union has these coals in it, and that's why I was looking at them, but they're not everywhere. All right, well, anyway, that's where I am with that project. It's not anywhere near done. And thank you for your attention.
Questions? Anybody?
How many grad student years went into this?
Which one?
Which one?
Bring the story together. There's a lot of data in there that had to be assembled.
Well, the substantive stuff was easy. I just did it on my own on weekends. I just pulled it off. I just pulled it off the data, digital well log data. On that part, the 3,000 wells, USGS did all that. The oil shale. They mapped out, they have publications on the oil shale deposits and their distribution, so that's easy. So this is really, so I would say a few grad student hours. Not really. Yes, sir.
So the dynamic topography models are strictly based on tomography, on seismic tomography. There's no integration of gravity data.
No. It all comes from tomography plate. You don't have any ancestral gravity data, but it all comes from.
You don't have ancestral tomography data either.
No, but you play it. You assume that everything is generated by the plate. It's the Farallon. You're making the assumptions. It's the Farallon plate, and its temperature is conductive T loss.
No attempt to calibrate it though to a tomographic model.
That's the modern. I'm thinking about that.
Yeah.
I don't know. I would be surprised if they haven't.
Be interesting.
I have to think about that. The gravity data is going to be more sensitive to the isostatic component than to this deeper layer because there's even a fluid between it. So. It's a good question I'd have to ask.
Maybe you can model it and get a residual, a lower...
No, I understand what you're saying. I will have to ask one of my friends who do that, if the modern images, how they're tied to gravity. I think there is a tie to some geoidal data, but I don't know what it is. Yes, sir.
On the borehole logs, they're looking for oil shale or whatever they're looking for as they bore down. What else do they log accurately with depth? They log a lot of different data?
Well, the key word there was accurate.
Well, I mean, you talked about a 30-meter level of oil shale, so that's better than 1% accuracy of the length of the bore.
I see what you're saying. I don't know, because these publications were all on the oil shale.
Wait, so oil shale's a topic, so they logged oil shale. So
yeah, but maybe these are probably extant well logs.
Are there other layers down there that are distinct layers that you could track along all these wells? The oil shale's been tracked, so
yeah.
What else is there that might be?
Well, if there was an ash, like John suggested,
yeah, okay.
Features like that would be perfect, because you really want a datum. That's why we like the oil shale top.
Thin point.
And so when you start talking about the difference between the Cretaceous, the marine non-marine boundary, if you could identify it, you know, that's going to vary in time and space. So I feel like the oil shale is a pretty good one.
Yeah.
I don't know. Again, an ash is an interesting idea, and whether you can just find the distinctive ash in well logs, something you should tell me.
You can. Yeah. That's,
you can tell this is ash A and that's ash B.
Absolutely. I mean, they look almost
because
like they tend to look almost like a cone. They're very.
They look like a cone.
Yeah. You're looking at the gamma ray. They're very.
They're big. They're high. They're.
Yeah, they're hot.
Very hot. Yeah, I have to think back and look at the well logs I've seen. So in these well logs, even if they're hot, but they're averaging over a couple of feet, they're still hot.
Oh, yeah.
Even if it's over integrated over. Huh?
Yeah, I mean, if you get.
I don't know if I've ever seen. I don't know. I wouldn't know. I
guess. Should be cuttings logs too, which are not nearly as.
Clearly, you work for a company. These are just, you know, these guys run hot and heavy.
No, but I'm saying that's how you actually know what the lithology is.
Yeah. No, we're
so
taking it off.
Somebody's looking at the rock.
I use gamma mostly.
How far back would, I mean, what's the oldest marker that would be functional? 65?
Well, I mean, if you really want to, I mean, if you could, you could probably recognize the Dakota shoreline, 100 million year shoreline is.
So, what about iridium then?
Oh, the iridium?
Sure.
But you'd have to process an awful, you'd have to have a sample, not a well log.
Oh, right.
And you'd have to process an awful lot of samples to find it, and you won't find it everywhere. Iridium is sort of, you know, it's hit and miss, I'm afraid. So, like at the KT boundary where you know from the fossils it's there, you can't always find it.
Five or six more graduate students.
No, that would be, you know, but the ash is very interesting. I'm going to have to really think about what
you
can do with ash.
You may not be able to get access to the samples.
Right.
Yeah.
And also,
that's
on,
a lot harder.
On the data, do you find that they're trying to protect the data by proprietary interest from people who are drilling these boreholes?
Nobody's drilling anymore, so they probably don't care. But
maybe they should.
No, there's some. There are cores available, but I'm not going to get 3,000 cores. Right. I'm not going to find 3,000 cores.
No.
I just take that one on carte blanche.
Well, there won't be cores too much. Cores are expensive.
Yeah, they're not going to core. So it has to be something on well logs
long
I can see.
Virtually every well log.
Yeah,
I'm just saying. Every well that is drilled by an oil company has to be logged.
Okay.
The most fundamental log you get is a gamma ray neutron log. SP, some of those static potential, I've forgotten. SP, anyway. So
Spontaneous potential,
that's it. Every log has that. And then you can have sonics or density logs or things like this that they run in and they look at the density of rocks and things like that. And usually those have to be filed with the state. So it may be available. If there's a core in the well, good luck getting from it.
Yeah.
But even then, I'm assuming these are paleo horizontals, and a lot of these are just their environment. I mean, we correlate them. We call them the layer, or they call it, we give them a name of a formation. But there's no evidence, very little evidence. It's really synchronous over broad regions at the same time. And and I'm looking for things that I care if there's a couple hundred meters of deflection. So you could be easily off, I'm afraid, in the Cretaceous interior. I think the ashes are really good. But finding, you know, the sort of stratigraphy that exists in the Western Cretaceous, there's very few units in there that would be really a horizontal timeline. You know, even the beaches, like the Dakota, is time transgressive.
Paul, there's a 2-foot thick ash bed held within the mahogany lead, which I think would be an ideal place to start. And there are samples of it down in Denver at the USGS Core Repository. And it was the Euro mines that did most of those.
In the mahogany.
In mahogany.
What's in the frontier? What's in the Powder River Basin? Not frontier, sorry. What's in the Powder River Basin?
Well, in terms of things like oil shale, the coals.
Well, the coals are what I try to work in. They're not everywhere.
Yeah,
where the coals are, I can use them, and I will.
The ash beds, I don't recall
See, I don't know either. I haven't looked for them. I wouldn't know.
It has to be. There has to be some there. Whether there's anybody studying them or not, I have no idea.
But the correlation is going to be a lot tougher than
Well, he thinks that these guys tell me that they can correlate ashes. I don't know. To me, I'd be lucky if I'd ever see one. But if you can actually correlate them, yeah. Cool. If not, coal is what I've been looking at. The trouble is they're coal fields and they're not coal. So I may not be able to do the Powder River right. We're also in the Bighorn Basin now, which is not even as good as the Powder River. I'm doing what I can do. It's stratigraphy in the name of geophysics.
Don't you have any low log analysts over there? Reservoir engineering group or the energy group?
Oh, you're so optimistic, aren't you? The first question is, do we have any people? And then do they do this? No, in fact, the guy I'm working with, the Powder River Basin, is part of his old group in the School of Energy Research, Enhanced Oil Recovery Group. And, even in the Powder River Basin, he handpicks logs because, you know, I don't know what a... You know, he plots them all up in GIS, and he has to say, well, that's a bad pick, that's a bad pick. I'm not that elegant at all, so I don't do it. But so it's true, you could probably get a gamma ray kick. And if you can see a first gamma ray kick above X, you might say that's the same one and just see what happens.
Yeah.
I suppose we could try that. That's a good idea. Well, thank you very much for your attention. I appreciate it.
Sure.
John?